All right, so we've been talking about subspace clustering. We spent some time on low rank approaches. And the key nice property of the low rank approaches is that I can find the solution in closed form, and that if the subspaces are independent, then the matrix C has this block diagonal structure, and therefore it is zero for points I and j in different subspaces. But the challenge is that there was no theorem when the rank is wrong, the data is noisy, and so on and so forth. So we spent the next amount of time on this sparse subspace clustering method, where what we do is, as before, express the data as a linear combination of other data points, and now search for sparse solutions. The big minus relative to the low rank approach is that the solution is no longer in closed form. And in fact, I haven't even told you how we compute that solution. I'll spend some time on that today. But we did have the same theorem. We did have a theorem that C star was log diagonal if subspaces are independent. So from that perspective, insofar, everything we've seen, I think anyone would actually prefer this approach because I can solve it in closed form. This actually requires an algorithm. And then if there is no noise and the subspaces are independent, then the solution is log diagonal. So why in the world, why would one would prefer the sparse algorithm? The reason is, and that's what we're going to see in the classes today, is that first of all, it's possible to relax the independence assumption. We're going to have theorems of correctness without the independence assumption. The second is that we are going to relax the assumption of noiseless data, and we're going to show that it is possible to extend it to noisy data. Something that is true here, in the sense that we can have algorithms that do it, but without theorems. So that's what I meant here, no theorems. And so what we're going to see here today is that, one, SSC can be extended. Theory can be extended. To non-independent subspaces. Noisy data. And also to corrupt the data. And also to data without numbers. So let's see how we do that. Okay, so the first point that I'll start with is, what about this question of independent subspaces? And my point is going to be that this notion of independence is a little bit too restrictive. So just to remind you, right, independence means that the dimension of the sum on the subspaces is equal to the sum of the dimensions. That's the exact definition. Okay? And because we are assuming that the data is generic, namely that the data points within each subspace span the whole subspace, that becomes equivalent to say that the rank of the data matrix is equal to the sum of the ranks of the data matrix from the ith group. So the total rank is equal to the sum of the ranks. So nothing is lost rank-wise. That's what really independence. But immediately you could have situations, and I think I presented the situation like this one. I've got three lines. The dimension of the sum of the three lines is 2, because they lie in the plane, so it cannot be more than 2. But the sum of the dimensions is 3. So this is a case where, in fact, the intersection is still the origin. Pairwise, you know, actually they are disjoint. But they are not independent. And therefore, this would be a case where the theorems we've discussed so far would fail. Okay. So here is a theorem that is much more generic and doesn't require assumptions of independence. And in fact, this is kind of broadly applicable. So, because today is the last class and I'm behind schedule, unfortunately I won't be able to provide a detailed proof. The detailed proof will probably take me at least one entire lecture. And I want to cover both theory as well as a little bit the algorithms, because you will need the algorithms for the project. So I will just state the theorem and explain it and try to provide an intuitive explanation as to why the theorem is true. Okay? So what the theorem says is that there is a quantity that you see on the left called the incoherence. And that quantity effectively measures the separation between the subspaces. It is not exactly that, and so I'm going to cheat a little bit just to be able to explain this easily. But the incoherence, and that's what I'm going to put here is approximately, is something like the cosine of the angles between pairs of subspaces. And this is really what you do, that you take the maximum and you put the average. So if you remember, what was the notion of coherence for classical compressors and sparse rope heaters? It was simply take the angles between pairs of data points, right? And in fact, it was the dot products, actually, between data points. If the data points are normalized, the dot product is the cosine of the angles, okay? So effectively, the notion of coherence, just in classical sparsity, is simply the cosines of the angles between the data points. Okay. So this is a slightly different notion, which is the cosines of the angles between subspaces. What are the angles between subspaces? Well, I did spend a couple of lectures ago talking about principal angles, right? And I defined what they were. Okay. So this is exactly that. That you take the principal angle between the subspaces and you compute the maximum possible cosine. Here, this is reduced, so this is the first, if you wish, first non-zero principal angle. Why am I talking about this first non-zero yada yada? Well, you might remember, if I give you two subspaces, right, what are the angles between them? They're as many as, let's say, two subspaces of the same dimension. The number of principal angles is equal to the dimension of the subspace. So if I have two planes, in R3, there are two principal angles. And you might remember, because we covered this in detail, that I said that the dimension of the intersection between two subspaces is equal to the number of angles that are equal to zero. Okay? Right? And so, that's what I mean here by the first non-zero, right? Because otherwise, the maximum cosine would always be equal to one. Okay? So in the case of two planes in R3, it really is the angle we are thinking about, the angle between the two planes. Okay? And then you take the largest among all pairs. Okay. So then there is this second quantity. So as you see, this is a quantity that depends exclusively on the subspaces. Okay. Has nothing to do with the data. The second one is this quantity called the radius. Set of points in radius of some polytope that is a function of the data of x. Here again, I'm going to be cheating. I'm not going to explain this exactly. So I'm going to maybe put my approximation sign over there just to convey the intuition. But pictorially, and this is not an exact analogy, but the idea would be as follows. Suppose that I've got the data, suppose for the the sake of simplicity, this is one subspace, and I've got a plane and two lines for the sake of simplicity. You know, the data points in principle might be anywhere, but these theorems, and this is perhaps a weakness and an opportunity for improvement, these theorems all assume that the data has been normalized to be of unit norm. Okay? Something that is very common in the results on compressed sensing, and that in the case of subspace clustering may or may not make sense. When does it make sense? It makes sense for a union of linear subspaces that go all through the origin, obviously. Because in that case, if you scale the data, right, the data still lies in the same union of subspaces. As opposed to if the subspaces are affine and they're there, once you scale them, you destroy the geometry. Okay? So in particular, what happens if you know, take many points in the plane and project them to be a unit norm? What do you get? Can anyone tell me? Actually, more broadly, forget about subspaces. I've got data, randomly generated in RD, or in R3 if you want. What happens if I project it to be a unit norm? Where is the data now? Is it in a parabola? Is it, where is it? Huh? In a sphere, right? It lies on a sphere. Now, if I've got data on the plane, and I project it to be a unit norm, then I get the intersection of the sphere with that plane. So I get something like a great circle. So this is what's going to happen here, that the data is going to lie in that circle, corresponding to that plane, after projecting it to be a unit norm. Okay, so for two lines, right, what happens if I ensure that the data now is of unit norm? I'm going to get, again, the intersection of the sphere with that line. What is that going to give me? What happens if I take a sphere and I intersect it with a line? What do I get? Two points, two antipodal points, like the north pole and the south pole. Right? So therefore, for this line, what I'm going to do is that I'm going to generate like that point and that point, right? But from the plane, I could get many such data points. Right? So that's how the data looks now once it is projected to be a unit norm. Okay? So what's going to happen now, and this is where I'm going to say it's approximate. A polytope is just this polygon that I form by all of the data points. In fact, more precisely, I think there is always the plus minus. Why do I need the plus minus? The reason is sort of as follows. Where does this thing come from, by the way? Just trying to bring the basic intuition. I'm expressing the data as a linear combination of data points with coefficients, right? You might remember that that's what we're doing, right? Okay? And so, if you think about it, any point that is a linear combination of many of them, right, then must now lie in the convex hull of those data points. And in fact, in one of the extreme vertices of the convex hull. Okay. And so why do I need plus and minuses? Is because these coefficients, they're the sparse coefficients. They could potentially be both positive or negative. So if I start thinking in terms of convex hulls, right, convex hulls usually are defined with non-negative coefficients. But because here I have a negative coefficient, to make it positive is equivalent to replacing xj by minus xj. Okay, so effectively it's saying that a point is a linear combination of many other data points is sort of equivalent to saying it's a combination with positive or non-negative coefficients, but I'm allowed to flip the sign of the data point. And here, right, whether it's that point or the other side, is the same from the perspective of lying in the subspace. So that's where we consider this polytope generated by the data points, but also with the minus. Okay, so this is just an introduction to the pictures that are going to come next. There is one extra piece of information. Again, I deeply apologize that I'm really by any mathematical standards, I'm not doing something rigorous, but I have no time to go into all of the details. So there is some theorem pertaining the L1 norm that I think it's important to convey. Suppose that I'm solving that optimization problem such that x is equal to x is c. Okay. And suppose that these guys are of unique norm. Okay. So, solving this problem from the perspective of this picture, and I'm just going to redraw it. You know, there's a single subspace here. I've got all of these points that are now unit norm in there. I form the polytope. Okay? And this is, you know, this, the x here is just exactly goes x1 to xn data point. And now suppose that I give you a point x here. Okay? And I'm trying to express this x as a linear combination of all these data points, but trying to find the smallest L1 norm for the coefficients. Okay? So there is a theorem, and I'm not going to state it in details, but it's very important that you understand the geometric intuition. This is equivalent to taking this polytope and making it bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger up until eventually it hits that data point. And when it does, that's when you found your optimal solution. Okay. So in a sense, there is this intuition being built that I'm trying to represent a point as a linear combination of the others with the smallest number of coefficients. And I can do that by taking the polytope and scaling it up until it hits exactly that layer. This polytope is, in a sense, it's almost as if this was a circle and it has a radius 1. And what I'm trying to do is express a data point as a linear combination of points in that circle with radius 1. But I cannot because the point is outside. And I'm only allowed to do convex combinations, right? So a convex combination of points here would only produce points that are inside. So the only way I can express a point that is outside is by scaling the point. Now, so the next thing is the following. For subspace clustering in particular, for subspace clustering, we have the following question, right? We are expressing the data x depending on the subspace that it belongs to, and then all of the other data points. And now I have these coefficients. We went through the proof of this last time, in fact, when we did the proof that for independent subspaces, the coefficients corresponding to other groups are zero. That's what we did, right? We split the data into the L subspace and all the others. So effectively, from a purely geometric competition, what is it, what's really going on? I am a point, and I can be expressed in terms of other points in my own subspace, or I can be expressed in terms of all of the other data points. Okay? So this pictorially is like a competition, a fight between points in my own group and points in the other groups. Okay? So the points in my own group, they generate the polytope sub L, if you wish. And these guys over here generate the polytope. Let me call it minus L. And so the question is, are these guys going to express me the best? Or are these guys going to express me the best? And if I go back to this picture, you can immediately imagine, right? I'm going to have one polytope, and I need to grow it to hit that guy. Now, the points in other groups are going to have their own polytope, and they're going to grow until they hit this point. So when or how can I guarantee with a theorem that this guy is zero? I can guarantee only if my own polytope reached me first. And reach me first is in the sense of the smallest possible scaling I need to do to that point. Okay. So, as you can imagine, I would have a very different situation on how this polygon looks like depending on how many points I have there and how they're distributed. And so let me give you another example, right? If I have a situation now where this is the circle, and I only have one point there, of course I need to do the antipolar points. Now this polytope all of a sudden became really tiny teeny, right? So if I need to reach this guy, I will need to grow this polytope a lot before it hits there. While if the points are uniformly or very well distributed and I have a lot of points, I will be able to reach that guy faster. Right? Okay? Is all of the intuition clear? So with that intuition in mind, let me tell you what that in radius quantity really means. So what is the in radius of the polytope? It's really, you look at a circle inside that polytope, and that quantity over there, I'm going to call it in radius. Okay? So is the radius of the largest circle that I can put inside the polytope generated by the data points of the I. And this is a case where the in radius is tiny teeny, and this will be a case where the in radius would be almost one, right? In fact, think about it. There is the sphere that I started with. That sphere has radius one. Inside that sphere, I've sampled many data points. And now I'm trying to put a circle inside that polytope, or the largest possible radius. If I had sampled in the continuum, right, what would that radius be? Would be equal to 1. So 1 is the maximum possible that I can achieve. But in this particular case, where I have very few points and they're very skewed, right, the in radius is tiny, much smaller than 1. Okay? So with that intuition in mind, what does this theorem say? And I'm going to illustrate it with pictures in the next slide. What the theorem says is that the incoherence, which is the largest cosine of the angles between the subspaces, need to be smaller than the in radius. So what does that mean in practice? I would like the in radius to be large. That would be a good idea. And I'd like the incoherence to be small. What does it mean to have large in radius? Well, we just go here. This will produce a small in radius. This will produce a large in radius. So I want to have a large in radius. How do I achieve that? If the points are well distributed in that circle, I'll get a large in radius. If the points are skewed along particular directions, I'll get a small in radius. Okay? So what this theorem is saying is really you would like the data to be well distributed in the subspace. And this situation is better than that situation. The second part is what the cosine of the angles needs to be small. So that means that if the cosine is small, the angle is large. Okay? So when comparing a situation where the subspaces are orthogonal to a situation where the subspaces are very close, the preferred situation is that the subspaces are far apart. So let me illustrate that now with pictures. Okay? So that's exactly what I've been saying. And so let me now illustrate the two competing polytopes. So the set of points, the red points in here, those are the points in subspace I, and they form this polytope P sub I. Okay? The points outside, the points in the lines, are these four points. And as you can see, now you have this second polytope, the polytope minus I. Okay, so that's exactly what I was trying to write here. That one. And so look at the polytopes, right? The dashed one, this is forms that rectangle over there. And that dashed one is the polytope of points in other groups. So I'm trying to express x now, which is the new point to be clustered. And that point x, I'm going to express as a linear combination of all of them. And my question is, will the red polytope win? Or will the dashed polytope win? Okay? And so if you look at the picture, right, which one do I need to scale by the least amount in order to match x? It'll be
this one, right? Because effectively, if you look at it, the rectangle, it's kind of inside the other. Okay? Now, think about the situation of the, okay, so that is a case that pictorially, it will succeed. The situation described on the top right, what did I do? All I did here was I kept the plane and the data points the same. There was no change whatsoever. But I reduced the angle. I make the lines a little bit closer to the plane. What happens when I do that? The polytope of all the other data points gets stretched, right? It became wider. And because it's wider now, it's closer to the point X, right? And now, therefore, the rectangle will reach X before the polytope of the red points. Is that clear? So that's illustrating if the angle reduces, there is more chance to fail. The third example that is here at the bottom is an example now where I go back to the original geometry. The subspaces and their angles are the same. But what I did is that I changed the sampling of the data points in the red plane. And I now have very few of them, but more than very few. The important thing is that they're very skewed. They happen to be exactly in opposite directions relative to that x. So what happens now is that the polytope of the P sub I became smaller, in a sense, because the data points are not well distributed. And now, which one is going to win? Again, the rectangle that is outside will win and reach X first. Okay? So that's the geometric intuition that justifies the theorem. Of course, behind there is a lot of algebra and equations and proofs and polytopes and geometry, but I hope this picture conveys the idea as to why the method works. Right? Is that clear? So, next thing I wanted to say. Is this condition easy, hard? How does it compare to the other? Can I verify? And so here's the deal, right? First of all, it's weaker than independence. If you think about the independence condition is only on the subspaces. There is not much on the data. Very minorly, of course. The only condition on the data is that they span the subspaces, because to make it for the rank, right, I like the rank of the data in the ith group to match the dimension of the subspace. So comparing with independence is, look at what happens here. It says they're independent, but what about the angles? Well, they can be small, they can be small, they can be small. They can be epsilon tiny, and the theorem will still be valid. And the reason is that you've got this more global geometric and algebraic condition, which is very independent. And that allows you to tolerate tiny, teeny angles. The condition on the data is they just need to span the subspace. So in fact, if I go back to the pictures, these red points span the plane, these other red points span the plane. If they're independent, I don't care how they're distributed, in a sense, as long as they span the plane. So in a sense, the condition on distribution of the data and the condition on the angles is weaker. But that is compensated by this assumption of independence, which is way stronger. In the new theorem, there is no assumption of independence. So the subspaces will be allowed to intersect, but that is compensated by the fact that the angles need to be larger and that the data need to be better distributed. Now, that being said, I insist, are these conditions easily verifiable? Could I verify this? Well, yeah, once you have the segmentation. But if you don't have the segmentation, there is no way to verify this, right? Even the independence condition, right? It's just you need to make that assumption to begin with. Likewise, the conditions that are stated here are not verifiable either for two reasons, right? The first one, the incoherence depends on the angles of the subspaces. Again, that's just geometric conditions. If I just use the data without estimating the subspaces first, you wouldn't know what the angles are. And similarly, for the distribution of the data, right? Because you need to get the in radius of the polytope of the points that are in the ith subspace. You need to know the segmentation to complete that. So in a sense, these theorems are not verifiable from the data alone. But that's okay, and actually that's true of many theorems, right? There are a
a little bit abstract, but at least it's good to have this safety that at least you know a situation where it works. But just to be practical, right, it's not like you will run the algorithm on the data, you will cluster it, and then you can verify. Because if the conditions are satisfied, you know that the algorithm will work, and then once you verify the conditions, they should be satisfied. But a priori you don't know. If the algorithm fails, then in any case, the theorem is a sufficient condition. So it could also be the case that these conditions are violated, and you still get a good cluster. So the next theorem tries to address that situation by effectively trying to do the following. And maybe I shouldn't write it down, but look at the differences. First, there is an extra assumption that is made that all subspaces are of the same dimension. But what it says is, suppose that you just randomly draw some subspaces. How could you do that? Well, there are lots of ways to do that, but okay, if you want to just have a MATLAB answer to the question, right? You could do something like rand n of n comma d times rand n of d, well, this would be d and d comma n. That might be a random way of generating data in one subspace in some random basis. Of course, you could do a little bit better, but that's the first point. Suppose that you generate the subspaces at random. And suppose that within each subspace, you also generate the data at random. Suppose then that you go ahead and you solve this optimization problem with randomly generated data. Okay. So now, what you can ask is, because this process is random, and just suppose that you're doing it a million times, you could, because you generated the data, you can verify the conditions. You can compute the radius, you can compute the subspace angles. You're generating the data. And now you do this a million times, and you say, okay, did it work? Namely, were these conditions satisfied, or were they not? Okay. And let's say that you were so lucky that 999,999 out of the million, it worked. This would tell you all the method appears to work most of the time. Okay. So more formally, what you're really trying to do is to compute what is the probability that the incoherence is smaller than the ingredient. For all subspaces, in fact, because remember, these quantities are subspace dependent. So actually, in fact, if you want to be a little bit more rigorous, where you're really trying to compute what is the probability that the largest, well, maybe I should just write it down. It's all for all I plus one. That's the probability that you're trying to compute. Okay? So, what this theorem says is effectively the following. If the dimension of the subspaces, forget about this bunch of logarithms and quantities, but suppose that it was a constant of time. If the dimension of the subspaces is smaller than the ambient dimension by some factor, in other words, really, if the dimension of the subspaces is sufficiently small, then, if, effectively, let me work down the theorem. If the dimension of the subspaces is sufficiently small relative to the ambient dimension, then the Cij star equal to zero for Xi and Xj are the different subspaces. With very common notion, overwhelming. That's what this theorem says. Let me actually try to find it. You have it in the book, of course. But let me see if I can find the formal statement. So here you get exactly the probability. So it's 1 minus 2 over n, n is the number of data points, minus n e to the minus rho times d. What is rho? Remember, rho is a little bit like the density of data points. So if we go back here, one of the assumptions is that the number of points per subspace is rho times d plus 1. So rho is expected to be bigger than or equal to 1, so that you sample at least d plus 1 points per subspace. Okay? So going back to the statement of the theorem, right, and in addition, right, you know that the number of subspaces, the number of data points is rho times d plus 1. That's how many per subspace times the number of subspaces. So typically, the overwhelming probability means that the probability goes to 1 when the number of data points goes to infinity, right? So how do we make the number of points go to infinity here? We let, for example, rho go to infinity, if you wish. And so what this says is that the probability 2 over n goes to 0, and then in which, okay, here you have n, which is infinity, but then it's e to the minus the square root, right? So now the limit is more complicated. But if you have a polynomial and you have an exponential, which one means? When you put limits? The exponential. So it will go to zero. It's infinity times zero, but the zero, the exponential is more important. Okay? So that tells you that with overwhelming probability, the method will succeed. And by succeed, we mean that the CIJs are zero for points xi and xj in different subspaces. So the rest is what is the constant and how small the dimensions need to be. So again, you have effectively something like a ratio of logarithms, right? In the numerator, you've got that C of rho is a constant that depends on rho, but there is an upper bound for it. So effectively, you can assume that the C is really a constant. So it's really just the ratio of these two logarithms. And both of them have rho in them. Okay. So pictorially, at the end of the day, what this says is that if this is the dimension of the subspace, right? If this axis is the dimension of the subspace, effectively, for all small dimensions, you can effectively get perfect recovery. And then there is some threshold, and that threshold is exactly what I had over there, c squared log of rho divided by log of n times d. Once you hit that threshold, from then on, the algorithm is no longer guaranteed to work. Again, it's a sufficient condition, so you could still go, but in practice, what you observe is that you have that, and then maybe the error. So let's say this. If you count here the number of CIJs that are different from zero, okay? Just to count how many mistakes are made. So here there's no wrong connection whatsoever,
and then it starts growing. Again, this is in probability, right? I'm not saying that there is really no wrong connection at all. I'm just saying that with very large probabilities. Is that clear? Okay, so I think in summary, the summary of this discussion I hope to have convinced you is the following, going back to my initial picture. In the noiseless case, Lorentz subspace clustering is closed form and guaranteed to work for independent subspaces. But it will fail when the subspaces are not independent. In that case, sparse subspace clustering has the disadvantage that you have to solve an optimization problem. There is no cross-form solution. But now you have theory of correctness for independent, as well as for non-independent subspaces. And the nice thing of it is that, in fact, if you just want to apply this at random, the key condition at the end of the day is the dimension needs to be sufficiently small. So in fact, you can reduce this. SSC works provided that the dimension of the subspaces is sufficiently small relative to the ambient dimension. And of course, it works when it works better also if you have more data points. Because since the data points are distributed uniformly at random, what really happens is the more data points, the more uniformly distributed they will be, the larger the radius, and so in probability, it's better to have more points. So in fact, we have observed this. Several years ago, we were trying this method just on 10,000 data points, but now recently we did a plot, performance versus number of data points, and you can get them to work better for 100,000 or for a million data points than you can for 10,000. Next thing, what do we do when the data is corrupt? So let's suppose now that there is noise. So continuing my table, right? Now I'm in the noisy case. And here, what we do in Lorentz subspace clustering was minimize with respect to C. I think we had a nuclear norm here. And we need x minus xc continuous squared. Is that what we did? And I forget now, we put a tau, and I forgot whether the tau was here or there. Can anyone remind me? And then we said that C star was V1 identity minus 1 over tau, lambda 1 minus 2, V1 times. That's what we did in the last class. Anyone reminds me where the tau was?
Second.
The second term, so there was a tau here. It wasn't divided by 2, I hope?
2.
Okay. So, again, the class is that we can do this in closed form, as before. But now we have no theorems. Okay, so what we're going to do now is in the case of SSC, we're going to try to do the same thing. So, we're going to do mean then one norm plus lambda over 2 x minus xc Frobenius squared. And then we still have the diagonal of c needs to be 0. And that's the problem we're going to try to solve. Okay? So in this particular case, the question is, does it work and why? First, I wanted to convey a little bit the idea is that where do these optimization problems come from and what is it that they are trying to do? So the idea is as follows. Suppose now that you say, aha, as we have done in our previous classes, okay, not this previous classes, as we did earlier in the class, I could say that the data is equal to the perfect data, and now I have noise. So this is the noisy data that is equal to the noiseless data.
area plus this. That's what I mean over there. So because the noiseless data is drawn from a union of subspaces, I know that for the noiseless data, I can write A is equal to AC, and the diagonal of C will be zero. Right? That's something we know. For the noiseless data, we are happy that's the constraint we should be using. But now A here, which is there, is equal to x minus e. So I can write this as x minus e is equal to x minus e times c, right? After that substitution. And so what I can write is that x is equal to xc plus e minus ec. And now I'm going to denote this guy here as e tilde. So the conclusion is x is equal to xc plus e tilde. And this e tilde is e minus ec. Right? Is that clear? That's the derivation that I just did. So here's the beauty. In fact, I could have done this for noise, but this could also be outliers. Okay? So in fact, let me do it immediately. This is for noise or outliers. In fact, any error, the derivation that I just did is true for any error. So think about what happens. And this is almost magic. Look, it says now that the noisy data, or the corrupted data, is equal to the corrupted data times the matrix of coefficients. But look at it. It's the same matrix of coefficients. There is no change whatsoever to it. So the coefficients are the same. So if my goal is to find that matrix of coefficients and use it for clustering, as it turns out, the equation is the same with the same matrix C. There is no modification to be made to C, which is the matrix that I'm after. But there is plus this extra term. And that extra term is noise plus or minus linear combinations of the noise with the same coefficients. So indeed, this e tilde, if e is noise, e tilde is noise, but it's some sort of structured noise with some coefficients. So if you're a statistician, then you would try to say, this is a Gaussian, this is a Gaussian. I now put coefficients in there, I'll get a Gaussian. But I get a Gaussian with structured covariance, because the C matrix will play a role in what that covariance will be. Okay. So if you want to go the rigorous statistical road, you would be able to estimate the subspaces, but you will get some sort of non-convex problem because of the structured covariance part. That it's like covariance depends on C. If you are a pure optimizer and you want to follow the model rigorously, you would write this as a constraint, but see, the issue is that you would have the error that is unknown multiplying the coefficients that are also unknown. So you would get a set of coefficients here, and you would get this part also would lead into a non-convex optimization problem. So what we're going to do is to sweep the difficulty under the rug and simply say e tilde is just some error. Okay, it's not going to be Gaussian with the same covariance as the original error. But if I do that right, then what I'm going to do is then minimize the L1 norm of C as before, because I still want sparse solutions. But now I'm going to, you know, E tilde is exactly X minus XC. And then the lambda that is in here, okay. So, in other words, what is this method trying to do? Instead of writing the data exactly as a linear combination of other data points, it's trying to do that approximately with some reconstruction error. That error doesn't follow exactly the distribution that we wanted, but nonetheless, it's still an error. and I am being lazy by forgetting about the structure of the error by just putting the reconstruction error in there. And now I still search for a sparse solution. Okay, so if we do that, as it turns out, people studied this optimization problem and they were able to show exactly extend this theorem. So the theorem before was, where was it? I didn't write it down, but the theorem before was if the incoherence is smaller than the radius, then the original SSE problem would give you a solution that is subspace preserving. That was the previous theorem. What does this theorem say? It says if the incoherence is smaller than the radius, which what does that mean again? If the subspaces are sufficiently separated and the data is sufficiently well distributed. But now there is this extra stuff. It says if the error is bounded, delta is the largest entry, if you wish, on that matrix E. If the error is bounded and is bounded above by this algebraic quantity that depends on the radius and the incoherence. Obviously, in the numerator, you have actually the difference between, look at what's in there. In the numerator, you've got the difference between that and that. Here, I just needed that difference to be positive. Now, potentially, that difference needs to be even larger, right? So in a sense, this is, intuitively, this is simply saying the subspaces need to be a little bit more separated. That kind of makes intuitive sense, right? Because if I had that, and I had a minimum angle theta with noiseless data, now that the data is going to be a little bit noisy, right? I probably want the subspaces to be a little bit more separated to compensate for the noise. So in fact, intuitively, you would expect that the separation of the subspaces should increase by the depending on the variance of the noise. So that's exactly what this is saying, okay? That the difference between the two needs to be larger and it's controlled by the amount of noise. If delta was zero, then we're back to just that, okay? And the third thing it says is that the regularization parameter that you pick, lambda, needs to be between some minimum and maximum. Why is that an issue? Well, if lambda were to go to infinity, what happens? If lambda goes to infinity, then it's equivalent to enforcing this constraint in equality. So lambda going to infinity reduces to the noiseless case. And so if lambda goes to infinity, effectively it's like I'm not tolerating any noise. I want exact reconstructions all the time. To be able to achieve exact reconstructions, probably I would, with noise, I would not have sparse solutions anymore. So this lambda effectively provides the trade-off on how much noise will I tolerate versus how sparse the solutions will be. Lambda is equal to infinity means little sparsity. Lambda small means that the solution would be very sparse. Because if lambda is small, then I don't care too much about how erroneous the reconstructions are. But this term is still there to say I really want sparse solutions. So that's why the theorem says that with noise, there will be a range for the choice of the lambda. And this is, again, the theorem that is the geometric theorem. This is not with overwhelming probability. This is an exact theorem. So effectively what it says, again, is if the subspaces are sufficiently separated, the data is sufficiently well distributed, the noise level is small enough, and the parameter of the optimization is chosen in the right range, then you can guarantee Cij will be exactly equal to zero when points I and j are in different subspaces. Okay, so that's what this theorem says. Next. What about data with outliers? So data with outliers, in fact, let me first do data with corruptions before data with outliers. Data with corruptions. So in data with corruptions,
think about the following thing. Suppose now that E, which is the matrix of errors, is sparse. Okay? So I'm going to take the data, and I'm going to make, for every column, very few corruptions. Suppose, in fact, that for the sake of argument, if I take the jth column and if I take the zero norm, is less than or equal to k, for the sake of argument. So think about the following. What happens to E tilde? E tilde is equal to E minus E cj. Take the jth column of E tilde. Is going to be equal to the jth column of E minus the jth column of this, and the jth column of this is E times Cj. So this Ej is essentially zero almost everywhere. This Ej should be zero except that a few of those entries are going to be non-zero, right? K of them. Then I've got the E matrix, and that E matrix is supposed to be sparse, right? Each column of it is supposed to have at most k non-zero entries. And now I'm going to put this Cj here, which is the, and that vector Cj is also supposed to be sparse, right? In fact, how many non-zero entries does this guy have? We already said that. The number of non-zero entries is equal to the dimension of the subspace, right? So let's say that this is D. Let me just for simplicity assume that it's all subspaces are of the same dimension, okay? So bottom line, what I'm trying to say is that the corruptions, the structured corruptions, if you wish to call the tilde ones, are equal to a sparse vector with at most k non-zero entries minus a linear combination of sparse vectors with sparse coordinates. Okay? Now, suppose, this is one extreme case, that I was incredibly lucky and that the non-zero entries were exactly the same, let's say it's three rows here. This is non-zero. Suppose that they were exactly there, right? What would happen? If I take this vector minus, what's going to be the sparsity level of the result? Well, because everything here is zero, right? Everything else is zero. Because I'm putting zeros in the corresponding rows, the zero part doesn't get touched in any way, right? So whatever calculation I do, if I'm super lucky and the matrix E has non-zero rows exactly coinciding with those, Ej tilde would be sparse. And what would be the sparsity level? The same as that would be k, right? Is that clear? Well, I repeat it once more. If the E matrix had exactly k non-zero rows, and those non-zero rows coincide exactly with those, then the result, after I take the difference, no matter what C is, in fact, it would be k squared. The reality is that the non-zero entries are going to be in different parts, right? And so what is the worst that can possibly happen? The worst that can possibly happen is that I start filling in the ones that were originally zeros with non-zeros, okay? But how many can I fill? Well, fortunately, right, there are only D columns that I'm gonna pick, right? Because this guy is sparse, I'm gonna choose only D columns to go. For the sake of simplicity, suppose that this guy was one sparse. This means that I'm gonna just pick one column. Suppose that I pick this one, okay? And I'm gonna add these two guys that were non-zero here, and I got very unlucky, they go into the ones that were zero, okay? So what happens in the end? That the level of sparsity is now gonna be k plus k, it's gonna be 2k. So I hope you're convinced via this argument that the L0 norm is bounded above by k times, and then here I'm going to have k times d, Because at most, I'm going to select little d columns from that matrix. And each one of them, at most, will have k non-zero entries. And the worst possible thing that can happen is that they are in different locations than what I had before. So this is actually the upper bound. Okay? And of course, in practice, maybe I expect that this would be closer to k. But the deal is the following. If the percentage of corruptions is small enough, and the dimension of the subspaces is small enough, the EJ tilde, so if k is small, and d is small, then all I'm trying to say is that E tilde is small. Okay? In spite of the fact that I'm not, I knew E was sparse to begin with, but it turns out that the E tilde is also sparse. Not as sparse as E, but still sparse. So as a consequence, this is a problem that makes sense. I'm just going to minimize the one norm of C plus lambda times the one norm of E tilde, such that X is equal to XC plus E. And I put the tilde so that will consider. So I hope that I've done a good job at motivating why this problem makes sense. Okay? Because what I'm going to do is decompose your data matrix as a linear combination of all other data points, tolerate some errors, but ensure that the coefficients are sparse and that the errors are sparse. Okay? And in theory, I should have done it with E, but if I do it with E, I'll get some multiplication there, and I don't want to go the non-convex route. Okay? So I'm lazy, and I do that. And E tilde. And the beauty of this, of course, you didn't tell me, but I need to still inform that the diagonal of C is 0. And the beauty of this is that this is a convex problem. Okay? And with this convex problem, I can simultaneously determine corruptions as well as find the clustering of the data. So let me move perhaps this. Okay. I believe that there is a recent paper that has theorems for the correctness of this method. At the time of writing the book, the analysis for this subspace clustering with corrupted data did not exist. But the algorithm for solving this problem had been developed much earlier. As of 2010, it was well developed. And this works actually very well in practice, but now there is a theory for that. But let's keep, because I only have 5 minutes. Okay. So maybe I should skip this outlier part and just go directly to the algorithm. How do we actually do this? Which algorithm do I do that would be the most effective to do? Let me just do the simplest one. There is no more time. But you can read the rest ones in the book. So, how do we do the simplest one? So, algorithm, SSC. Algorithm. Okay. So, the idea is to minimize the nuclear norm of C. L1 norm of C is such that X is equal to XC and the diagonal of C is. Okay. So the first thing we're going to do is to introduce an extra auxiliary variable, Z. And so now we're going to minimize with respect to C and Z. Same, and now what we're going to do is such that X is equal to X
the diagonal z is equal to 0, and c is equal to z. Do you agree that these two problems are equivalent? Yeah, I didn't do much, in fact, right? So the objective is the same, that constraint is the same. So the only change was that this constraint, I replaced c by z, but then I wrote the extra constraint that c is equal to z, so I didn't do anything with it. So the next thing is going to be, and that's what's there in the board, is to actually figure out that you can get rid of these constraints and just write the following. And this is just saying that z is equal to the diagonal, sorry, is equal to c minus the diagonal. Okay, so effectively, what I've done is to get rid of these two and replace them by just one constraint. Okay. Why can I do that? So, first, notice, what is the diagonal of z? What is the diagonal of z? Well, it's going to be 0, right? Because it's going to be this minus the diagonal of the diagonal is the same thing. So, this is 0. So, in fact, the fact that these two are equal and that the diagonal of that is 0 is being implicitly enforced on the z. Right? Agree? And in fact, I could have, I did that, but I could have done that here, right? Did math. Right? So that's exactly what's being done here. The one constraint has been eliminated. Okay? And so if the diagonal of C was 0, then I would get this array called and I would be back to them. So that's what that's the equation. Okay, so that's an initial reformulation to then just go into the classical thing we've done many times. So we write down the lambda function, C, Z, lambda 1, lambda 2, so it's equal to the objective function, plus Lagrange multipliers for the first constraint, which is x minus xz, plus Lagrange multipliers for the second constraint, which is lambda 2 times z minus z minus the diagonal of c. Okay, so I'm just copying, in fact, what is there, but I hope you follow, right? Objective, Lagrange multiplier for the first constraint, Lagrange multiplier for the second constraint. Now we're going to do the augmented Lagrangian approach. And so in the augmented Lagrangian, there is mu 1 over 2 times the square of the constraint, which is x minus xz from v is the square. And then we'll do the same thing with the other constraint. Number 2, z minus that of c from v is the square. So I hope the augmented Lagrangian is clear. Objective, lambda times the constraint, plus mu times the square of the constraint. Okay? So, now what we're going to do is what we've been doing forever at the beginning of the class. We're going to find the optimal C, the optimal Z, and then we're going to do a gradient ascent step on the Lagrange multipliers. We've done that many times. So, why did I do this splitting and all of this change of variables? Here is the thing. So z star, right, the optimal c, z. Let me see where we are. Should I do it for c first? Maybe for the c first. Give me 1 second. Okay. Yes, okay. Let me do it with c first, just to demonstrate one of them. C star is the arg mean of the L1 norm of C plus the second term, nothing to do with C. This term, yes. This, nothing. And this one, yes. But this is a quadratic.
plus linear. So this is the same thing as mu 2 divided by 2 of, am I doing, sorry, C, which one? Of Z minus C minus beta C plus lambda 2 divided by mu 2. Okay, so it's a typical strategy we have used over and over, which is we complete the square. Let me see if the completion of the square is correct. I get the square of this first part, let's fit it into this part. Do I have the square of this? Yes, that's right there. Plus 2 times this times that. The 2 will cancel with that 2. The mu 2 will cancel with that mu 2. And so I just get that times that. But that's exactly what I put there. Plus the square of the last one. Well, but that doesn't depend on C. So I don't care about it. And why do we do this? Because what we want to do is get the shrinkage thresholding all the time. And to get shrinkage thresholding, what I need is the L1 norm of C plus a quadratic on C. That's what we want. Okay? And that's exactly what's happened. By analogy, we can do the same thing with Z star. And so with Z star right now, actually with C star is going to be slightly different. We're going to get quadratic all over the place, I think. And therefore, we're just going to take the derivative. Okay, where is the C? I'm missing something. The C is there. It's all over the place. Okay, let me do it for once. In this case, I'll just complete the derivative. The derivative of this with respect to Z is what? Minus lambda 1. Be the derivative of this term. Okay, so with some transpose that I could be missing, plus lambda 2, maybe. That would be the derivative of this term. Then I've got a z in here, so that is x times I minus z. So something, it must be something like mu 1, x minus xz, and then probably an x transpose in there. That would be the derivative of this. And then I've got the derivative of that, which is going to be mu 2 over 2, 2 will always go away. And then I'll get z in there. And that needs to be equal to 0. Okay, don't believe everything I've written. There could be a plus or a minus sign and a transpose. But you know how to do this at this point in life. It's the last class. You better know how to do this better than me. So given that, let me just tell you what is going to happen. From here, you get a linear equation on z. So you can actually solve this in closed form. You can immediately see that you get mu 1 x transpose x plus mu 2 times the identity times z is equal to something, probably everything on the other side, maybe lambda 1 x minus lambda 2, something like that. Okay? You go ahead and do it. But you get a linear system, and so that's. And for the one on the top, you get a shrinkage thresholding. So that's exactly, and here is written down that correctly and much better. So here it is. The update on Z, which is what I was trying to get there, you get mu 1 x transpose x plus mu 2 times the identity. That's what I just wrote here. Inverse, to pass it to the other side. Multiplying a bunch of other stuff. Okay, so I guess you figure out that I didn't quite get it right, the right-hand side. Okay. Just you do it correct, okay? But it's a linear system, and that's how it is derived. So then you've got the update of C. The update of C is exactly shrinkage thresholding. Here it is, right? Shrinkage thresholding of Z plus lambda over mu. And that's exactly what is there, Z plus lambda over mu. Okay? And then the updates of lambda 1 and lambda 2 is what we have always done in ADNN. Is the new lambda is equal to the previous lambda plus mu times the constraint.
plus mu times this constraint, and the other one is with this constraint. Okay.
So it's exactly the same thing we've already done. Okay, so what is the summary? The summary is that you can find the optimal sparse coefficients via an iterative procedure called ADMM, where you solve for a matrix Z, which is a redundant extra augmented variable that you add by solving a linear system. You solve for the sparse coefficients via shrinkage thresholding, and you update the Lagrange multipliers effectively in closed form. Okay? And because the optimization problem is convex and ADMM has been... Actually, there is a little technicality. If you're really an expert in optimization, the classical results on convergence of ADMM were for two blocks. You have one variable versus the other. Here, effectively, we do have the two blocks. So this is to be guaranteed. Okay? The way by which you do the noisy versions is essentially almost identically the same, except that instead of having Lagrange multiplier for the constraints, they are directly in the objective. But because they are directly in the objective, you already have this term. You already have that term. In fact, the Lagrange multipliers are not there. So for the noisy and sparse versions, the algorithm is even simpler, because you don't have to update Lagrange multipliers. And so hopefully I've derived it and put it somewhere, but maybe not here, it should be a little better perhaps. The noisy should be here. Let's see if there is an algorithm. Maybe I don't have the algorithm. Ah, here it is, the derivation of the algorithm. That's exactly what I meant. In this particular case, that's the way you do the noisy case. In the noisy case, the Lagrange multiplier lambda 1 effectively disappears because you're just adding this to the objective to begin with, so it's equivalent to not having that. You still keep the constraint that the diagonal of C is equal to 0. So you still keep this term and that term. So how the algorithm is the same algorithm, except that the update for Z is a little bit simpler. Okay? And so here it is. So the bottom line is, all cases, noiseless, noisy, with outliers, can be solved with minor variants of each other by the same algorithm. And all of them are guaranteed to converge to these sparse solutions. And there are theorems for correctness of each one. Any other questions? All right, so this is the last lecture. Next Wednesday, no, next Friday, is the projects are due and the exams are due. I'll have extra office hours during next week. I'll just send emails to you with the time that I'll be available. I think you'll be available at the same usual time so far. Don't hesitate to contact us if there are any questions. And well, thank you. I would say thank you next Friday.